Hello everybody. Today we will be talking about a special part of the immune system, that is the complement system. Complement system consists of a series of proteins which complement or augment the functions of the antibodies. Again, what are complement system? Complement system consists of complementary proteins. There is a whole multiple series of proteins, the multiple proteins. And what are the functions of these proteins? These proteins basically complement the immune system and complement the inflammatory reactions. Or we can say these proteins augment the immune system work as well as augment the inflammatory response. We will see in this lecture that what are the complement proteins, how they are activated, why they are activated, what are the advantages of activating these proteins, what are the benefits to human beings by activating these proteins, and what are the dysfunctions of these proteins. If these proteins are overactivated, what type of problems are produced to us, or if these proteins are underactivated, what happens to us. First we will talk about the normal function, and then we will talk about the dysfunction of the complement system. Let's start with the normal function. The first question is, where the complement proteins are present and where they are produced in the body, right? Actually, complement proteins are mainly produced by the liver cells. So the source of complement protein in our body is mainly hepatocytes. Liver cells, you know, they produce a lot of proteins. As everyone knows that liver cells synthesize albumin, liver cells, hepatocytes produce many coagulation factors. In the same way, liver cells also produce a series of proteins which are about 20 or more than 20 proteins, and those proteins are called complement protein. Let's suppose this is your circulatory system. Here is your circulatory system. Here is your liver, and liver cells are constantly synthesizing and releasing complement protein and circulation, right? These different complement proteins which are produced, right? Okay, these different complement proteins which are produced in circulatory system, right? There is not one protein, there are about 20 or plus proteins, and these proteins interact with each other. And do you think in a normal person blood who does not have any inflammatory reactions or any immunological reactions going on, do you think in normal person's blood complement proteins are present?
Yes.
What do you think?
Yes, they should.
Yes, they are. Complement proteins are present in your blood all the time. Is that right? Basically, complement proteins are proenzymes. These are inactive proteins. These are inactive enzymes. They are constantly being produced by the liver, added to your blood, right? And but they are activated only during the inflammatory reactions and immune mediated reactions. Is that right? So major source of complement protein is liver. That is what a good doctor knows. But there are some doctors who are great doctors. They know more than this, that some of the complement proteins are secreted by the macrophages. Another important exception. Complement protein number 1 is mainly produced by the GIT mucosa. That is an exception. Most of the complement proteins are produced by liver. But if you really want to know exceptional things, many of them are also produced by macrophages. And complement protein number 1 is mainly produced by GIT mucosa. Is that right? Anyway, all of them are normally present in your blood. Is that right? Now, let's see how they work, right? We take a practical example that there is a bacteria present in your tissue. Okay, we make one bacteria here. What do you think? It's coccus or bacillus?
Bacillus.
Okay, he has high general knowledge. He knows it's bacillus, not coccus, right? Cocci are actually circular, spherical, right? So this is one bacteria. And of course, let's suppose this bacteria has these antigens. These are bacterial. These are bacterial antigens. And you know, when immune system is activated, immune system make antibodies against the bacterial antigens. Is that right? Let's suppose you have made an antibody against this bacterial antigen, and you know antibodies are basically, yeah, they are two heavy chains, antibodies, and they are having two light chains. All these chains are held together by, yes, what are these? Disulfide bonds. Remember the structure of antibody. Antibody is a tetrapeptide. Antibody is a tetrapeptide having two heavy chains and two light chains held together by disulfide bonds. This is a basic structure of the antibody. Let's suppose when this bacteria entered in your body, it activated the humoral immune response, and eventually against these antigens, antibodies are produced. Right? There are many types of antibodies. Right? But antibodies which can specifically activate the complements, they are immunoglobulin belonging to M class, IgM, or immunoglobulins which are IgG. You know there are five main classes of antibodies, right? There is IgM, there is IgG, there is IgA, there is IgE, there is IgD. The complement activating antibody classes are only IgG and IgM. Is that right? Let us suppose that against these bacterial antigens, our immune system has produced IgG or IgM. Any one of these is produced. Once your immune system has produced these antibodies, let's suppose here is your immune system. This is your immune headquarter. Right? You must be knowing that macrophage present the antigen to T helper cells. Macrophage take up the antigen, present to T helper cell, and T helper cell convert the B cells into plasma cells. And these plasma cells secrete the, yes, what is it? Antibodies. Basically, this antibody is tetrapeptide, but in a simple way, I've shown it like this. Now, these antibodies which are produced against this antigen, eventually these antibody will reach here, and what will happen? These antibodies will, yes, they will react with the antigen. This is an antibody, and now this antibody is reacting with the target antigen. Is that right? When antibody reacts with the antigen, there is a change in this tail of the antibody. It undergoes a change. It is just like that thing that if a boy is standing, there is no change. But if we interact with something, there is a change in boys. In the same way, when antibodies are not with the antigen, they don't have a specific change. But as soon as this antibody molecule reacts with the antigen, there is a change in it. What is the change in it? Let me tell you. Let's suppose this is the Fc portion of the antibody. And Fc portion of the antibody has a special loop here. Right? This point, these two points can activate the complement. But normally when antibody is not binding with the antigen, these loops are not available to the complement protein. But as soon as antibody bind with the antigen, these loops become exposed. We say antibody is activated. And here is the answer. You have a lot of antibodies moving in your blood, but they are not activating the complements all the time. Why they are not activating the complements? Because antibodies which are moving in your blood or antibodies which are present in your body fluids, they are without antigens. Until they are without antigens, they are not having the capability to activate the complement system. But as soon as antibody bind with the antigen, it undergoes a transformational change and it exposes special domains which can bind and activate the complement system. Advantage of this fact is that antibodies will not inappropriately activate the complement system, and antibodies will only activate the complement system when antibodies are sticking with the antigen. That means antibodies will activate the complement system only when there is a need of it. When there is a need of it. Now, as soon as these points are exposed, it means now this antibody, which is biting on the antigen, it is activating its tail. It is willing to do some function. Here, what is the function? To bind the complement protein and activate. Now, of course, if there are many bacteria here, there is some injury is going on. It means there is some inflammatory reaction here. And if there is some inflammatory reaction in this area, it means that endothelial cells here are, there is some inflammatory reaction going on. And during the inflammatory reaction, blood vessels are dilated, endothelial cells are shrunken, and there is increased permeability. Again, listen. Because in this area, bacterial invasion is there, and bacteria are damaging this area, so naturally, there will be inflammatory reaction, and due to that inflammatory reaction, there will be vasodilatation, as well as there will be increased permeability of microcirculation. So there will be more blood coming to this infected area, and there will be more proteins leaking out from vascular compartment into interstitial area of this tissue particularly. Because this become more permeable, so your sleeping dogs, who are your sleeping dogs? Complement proteins which are sleeping in the blood. Now they have a chance to come here so that they become active dogs. So what happens that from here, different complement proteins, they will come out, right? But yet they are not active. These are not active. They're sleeping. Now what happened? Actually, by chance, they will start hitting at this point. Whenever complement protein number 1, right, will hit over here, it will be activated. Is that right? Complement protein number 1 has 3 parts. Complement protein number 1, we can show like this, that this is complement protein number 1, right? And this has 3 areas, 3 legs. One leg is called Q, other is called R, third domain is called S. You know ABC, QRS, no need to be upset. And this QRS has nothing to do with the QRS complex of ECG. Is that right? So what happens, we say the complement 1 protein, right? It has 3 peptides, or special domains, QRS. This Q point can hook with, interact with activated antibody. Antibody in complex with antigen. So what really happens? Let's make it and see what really happens. That C1 will bind here, right? And when C1 will bind here, now you will tell me it has opened its eyes. It has become active protein or inactive? It has become active protein, right? And what are these points which are activating here? No, only Q is activating here. This is C1 which is activated. As soon as we come in touch with the antibody which is complexing with antigen, and which antibody? Not every antibody, especially IgG or IgM. Now it become active. When it become active, this is C1 activated. Complement number 1, we put a bar. When we put a bar, it means it is active, right? So next time what happens? This is inactive complement protein, and this is active complement protein. So we can put a bar on it. So in the books, when you find on there is a complement protein written with bar, it means it is which form?
Active.
Active form. So this is also active form. When it become active, it call some other friends, come here, there's an antigen antibody activity going, you are needed here. So its friends will come. What will be the next protein coming here?
C3.
Oh, not directly C3. It comes C4, right? Now, so second protein which comes over here, right, that is, that binds here and become active. Is that right? Very happy. Because it is being activated by C1. So C1 activates the C4. It activates, this was C1. Okay, I'll put it in black color. Or you want which color to be put here? Okay, this is C1. Now what is this? C4. Is that right? Why this protein is called C4? First of all, we should be thankful to the researchers. that there are many, many complement protein, and we should be thankful and obliged to those researchers who did not put their names on these proteins. They just call it protein number 1, 2, 3, 4. And these numbers are assigned according to the sequence in which these proteins were discovered. So unfortunately, protein number 4 was discovered before the 2 and 3. So that is why it looks a bit out of order. Is that right? But this was the order in which they were discovered. Right. So complement 4 is activated by C1. Right. Once it is activated, normally, now I have to make another diagram here. Let's suppose this is an inactive complement protein. It's just like a baby. And normally, it has a very special domain, and it is like a, yeah, what is it? It's look like? You have seen? It's apple, sure. So you can say this protein has two parts, a baby part and baby with apple. This complement protein has two part, baby part, apple part. Or we can simply say baby for, B for baby, and A for apple. So it's B part and this is A part. So most of the complement proteins have A for apple, B for baby. Not difficult to remember. This A and B, when they are complex together, they are inactive. When they are stimulated, look, baby is sitting like this with an apple on its head, and it is activated, what will happen to apple? It will go away. So what we will say, that when it is activated, right, baby become active, right, but apple has gone away. What is left behind is, for example, complement, which fragment? Baby fragment, B fragment. And which fragment has gone away? Complement? A fragment. Is that right? So many of the complement, right, they consist of a complete protein, and when that protein is activated, some of the complement break down to two components. One component is called B component, other component is called A component. Is that right? Am I clear? B for baby, A for apple. But here, B is not for baby. Here, B is for the fragment which remain binding with the original complex. One fragment fall away, other remain bound. B for binding. Let's see what happened. This was C4. When C4 is activated, which component is lost? Yes, please. Right? So what will be this? C4, A. And what will be this? C4, B. So what we can say? That one complement number 1 is activated by the antibody, Fc portion of the antibody or tail of the antibody, activate complement number 1, complement 1 protein activates the complement number 4, and complement number 4 hydrolyzes or breaks down into two components. One remain bound with this is called fragment B. One fragment diffuses away into fluid form, and that is called fragment A. So apple goes away, baby stays there. Am I clear? Now, once this baby C4B is there, it will attract another baby. And what is that baby? That also become active. And that is C2. And which fragment remain behind? B fragment. And which fragment will go away? Another apple will go away. This apple was from here. Another apple is from here. What is this? C, 2, A. Yes.
I had a question. Did C1 also have complement A?
Of course not, as we can see there.
It just started.
Yeah, it never had apple. It never had apple, it's not going to lose it. So her question was that, will C1 break into A and B fragments? Answer is no. C1 just touch the active antigen-antibody complex and becomes activated. And once it is activated, it produces the hydrolysis of C4 and then C2. So C4 break down to A and B component. B remain bound, A diffuses away. A diffuses away, A from away, going away, right? Then C4B will activate C2B. And when both of them are activated, C2 will break down also into A for away, A for apple, A for away. And C2B will be bound. Is that right? Any question here? Now, these two babies become naughty. They become active. They're very happy. You know, one baby is okay, but if two babies are together, mothers know what will happen. This complex is very active. They plan to activate one more molecule, which is the real central molecule of complement system. That is C3. Now there's a turn for the C3. So another baby is coming there, and this baby will be activated by C3, and it will also lose its apple. What will be that? C3? A. Right? And what will be left behind? C3? B. So it means that this complex, which is C4B plus C2B, this complex was able to convert the inactive C3 into active C3. Am I clear? These two babies were able to activate the next baby. So we can say the B fragment of 4 and B fragment of 2 together make a complex which can convert the C3 protein, complement number 3 protein, into B fragment and A fragment. It means these two can convert C3 from inactive form to active form. That is why these two baby group is called, another name for special name for this is C3 convertase. What is it called? C3 convertase. These two are called C3 convertase, which can convert the complement number 3 into active form. Okay, someone find the mistake in my spellings. I'm always weak in spelling, so I prefer to write it like this, that it is C3 convertase. Is that right? Now you're happy. Fine. So this is C3 convertase, these two. Now, how many baby together? This was one, how many B component? C4B, C2B, and now one B more is added. What is that? C3B. Now look, these three are more naughty. Now they become all of them together. You get it? All of them now, there is not the problem produced by two babies. How many babies?
Three babies.
Right? And this is baby business. They will activate one more baby. How many babies have gone? 1, 2, 3, 4. What is left now?
5,
of course. Usually 5 is after the 4, isn't it? So 5. Now, which protein will come into action? Complement number?
5.
So, all these three together now activate, wake up the protein number?
5.
Please be active. There is something bacteria here. Right? And now, right? See? 5. And it will, of course, lose its apple. So, what is lost? It will lose one fragment. C5A. And what is left behind?
C5B.
Is that right? It means that all three of them, all the red complex, which consists of C4B, C2B, C3B, all of them were able to activate which protein? So what should be that complex called?
C5 convertase.
You are yourself intelligent, isn't it? People have friends which are intelligent. C5?
Convertase.
So now we know, again, let's repeat up to now, how the complement system is being activated under these examples. Right? That there were bacteria here, and these bacteria have been in our body for significant time, so that this bacterium has activated the immune system. An immune system has provided the antibodies against this bacterial antigen. If these antibodies belongs to IgG group or IgM group, as soon as this antibody will complex with the antigen, especially if IgM as a singlet or IgG as a doublet, single molecule of IgM or double molecule of IgG, G, especially IgG 1, 2 and 3. IgG has 4 subclasses. So 1, 2 and 3, they can activate the complement. IgG subclass 4 cannot. But anyway, if IgG or IgM bind over here, the tail portion of the antibody, which is called Fc portion of the antibody, it undergoes transformational change. And during this, the molecule exposes the active part, which is able to interact with C1. As soon as C1 interacts with the antigen antibody complex, C1 becomes active, but it does not fragment. C1 does not break down into A and B. C1 is not a baby, right? And it does not have an apple. Okay, let's change its face so that you remember it is not a baby. It is not a baby, right? So don't talk about C1, B component or A component. Is that right? So this is for C1 is the mother. As soon as mother is activated by antigen antibody complexes, C1, babies will be activated in series. It's too logical to understand, right? Baby number 4 is activated first. Then it activates the baby number 2. So in this way, their apples are lost. So what we can say that C4 break down into A and B component, B remain bound with the initial complex and A component, apple components go away. Then C2 also break down into A and B, A moves away, B remain there. When C4B and C2B make a complex, they convert into a special proteolytic enzyme complex which is called C3 convertase, which can convert the C3, called the baby number 3, and activate that. Of course, any baby who has lost the apple will be very active and weeping and crying and disturbing, right? So C3B will be there, right? So the first two, these two together act as C3 convertase, right? As soon as C3B fragment is added to C3 convertase, whole complex is called C5 convertase. That is C4B, C2B, C3B. This C5 convertase will activate protein number 5, and protein number 5 will break down into C5A and C5B. And now C5B will be sticking to this. Is that right? C5B remain sticking to this main complex. In this example, suppose now what happens? Yes, what happens now? Actually, now this whole complex can do a very, very dangerous thing to bacterium. Don't forget bacterium. All these babies and their friends are coming to destroy the bacteria. They're not just playing a game for you. They're going to destroy bacteria. And now the real action will start. C5B opens a special pocket here. And who binds here? Yes. C6 and C7. And then with them, who binds? C8 and then C9. You know the counting, isn't it? So C5B will activate C6, 7, 8, 9. All this complex, now it is very important to understand, all this complex, right? This complex, what is that? C5B, C6, C7. First of all, these two bind with C5, and then what bind? C8 and C9. Let me tell you, what are these proteins? Actually, these are special type of proteins which have a shape like this. These are peptide molecules. These are special type of peptide molecule. These are very, very dangerous. You know, they're making a unity and then they become fight against it. All of them will make a circle. How they will make a circle? Look at it. This was C5B. On the flanks of it will become, yeah, C6 and C7. Then what will be added to further? C7 and C8. So, okay, C8 and C9. And all of them will come. They are laughing. They have made a friendly circle, which is least friendly to the bacterium. They're only friendly with each other. They will make a circle like this. So it means this protein, this is making a sort of complex which is having a pore in the center. Is that right? This complex can be also shown like this. They have assembled into a, what is this? Now let's suppose C5B. This is a peptide C5B. Width on the flanks, what are there? See?
Six.
And what was here? See? Seven. C6 and 7. And what were here? Yeah, see? 8 and 9. All these proteins assemble together and make a special type of membrane protein complex which have a central pore, and this will simply detach from here and fall on the bacterial surface. And when it will fall on the bacterial surface, what do you think? If on a simple membrane we put a very strong acid, what will happen to that? It will produce a hole. In the same way, this will fall on that and it will dissolve here like this. These protein complex, so repeatedly more and more complexes will fall. So do you think membrane is under attack or not?
Yes.
It is just like you are drilling holes in the membrane of the bacterium. Do you think bacteria will be very happy with this thing? It is just like putting a drill machine, grrr, 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 will it just survive longer? Same is true about bacteria. These biological molecules which are generated by activation of complement, especially C5B, 6, 7, 8, 9, these are very naughty, they circularize and then attack the membrane. So, this naughty group of activated complements are called membrane attack complex. So, the whole purpose of all this activation was to produce membrane attacks complexes. And these events, before that, these events are called early events or early steps in complement activation. And these are called terminal events or late events in activation of complement. Is that right? The purpose of whole this game was that we could produce membrane attack complex. What is membrane attack complex? This consists of the last components of the complement activation system. C5B, 6, 7, 8, 9, and they make pores, and they don't digest the membrane enzymatically, no, they don't do enzymatic damage to the membrane. They simply these circularize and mechanically they dissolve into lipid membrane of the bacteria, and then they produce, this disrupt the physical integrity of the bacterial membrane. These membrane attack complexes disrupt the physical integrity of the bacterial membrane. So, of course, can bacteria keep its private environment in? No. The things which are inside will leak out and unwanted things will move in. So, bacteria will die. Is it difficult to understand? This type of attack is, do you think, more effective on gram-positive bacteria or gram-negative bacteria? Gram-negative bacteria has outer lipid membrane. Gram-positive bacteria do not have outer lipid membrane. Let me tell you a little thing about gram-positive bacteria and gram-negative. What is the real difference? Gram-positive bacteria has lipid membrane in which it is, you know, cell membrane of the gram-positive. Here is cell membrane of gram-negative. These two things are common. Then gram-positive has lot of peptide. What is this? Glycans. These are special type of molecules. They make a very thick layer. Peptide molecule cross-linked by glycan units. So this is gram positive. Gram negative has a very thin peptidoglycan, and for their special function they are having outer additional lipid membrane. This is gram negative. This is gram negative, and here it is gram positive bacterium. What do you think? Membrane attack complex will more effectively attack the gram positive membrane or gram negative membrane?
Positive.
Where membrane is more accessible? Look, if I keep my hand too much exposed, chances of being attacked are more. The best way to confirm is walk on the road, very busy road like this. Is that right? Is that right? But if you keep it like this, less chances to be attacked. Gram positive has membrane only inside. Gram negative has a membrane outside as well. So, membrane attack complex can more effectively destroy gram negative bacteria and less effectively going and destroying gram positive. Now you may be thinking, why am I highlighting this thing? Because in some inherited disorders, you don't have these proteins. And the people who do not have enough complement proteins, which play a role in the last part of the complement system. For example, if Mr. Abdul does not have C5B or 6, 7, 8, 9 or any one of them is deficient, especially C6, 7, 8, 9, we call them terminal components of the complement system. If he has deficiency of this, problem will be mainly with gram-positive or gram-negative handling?
Negative.
Gram-negative. So gram-negative bacteria will attack him more. So Mr. Abdul will suffer specially with some special bacteria. Right? For example, Mr. Abdul and Mr. Ehsan, they are having the same activities and both are getting the gram-negative bacteria, but Mr. Abdul has less these components, so he will suffer with gram-negative bacteria more. Who will suffer? Abdul or Ehsan? Abdul. And you know which one, which special type of gram negative? You really want to know? There's a very special type of gram negative which specially attack those people very severely who do not have these components. We don't know why especially those gram negative are too much active in these people. You can guess about Mr. Abdul. Even though the activities of Abdul and activity of Ehsan are same, but same bacteria are being exposed to both of them, but he has more chances to suffer with recurrent infections of those bacteria, right? Abdul has more chances because he has less these components and he has less chances. Of course, bacteria are gram negative, but a very special group of gram negative. You know gonorrhea, gonococci? You don't know gonococci? You know gonorrhea infection, sexually transmitted bacteria, gonorrhea or gainorrhea, whatever you call it. But these gonococci or gonococci, whatever you love to call them, right? And plus meningococci. Gonococcal infections and meningococcal infections are especially more severe and more recurrent in the patient who have deficiency of terminal components. Is that right? Am I clear to you? Right? So, gonococci and meningococci as a group are called Neisseria. They are called?
Neisseria.
Neisseria. The spellings are like this. Neisseria group of bacteria. Some people lied. I suppose it is right. But anyway, you understand even if it's not right. Is that right? So next time, if your MCQ it appears, a person is repeatedly experiencing the Neisseria infections or gonococcal infections, what's wrong with him? Of course, one reason may be that he's having too much sexual activity in a very much reckless fashion. But other reason may be that he's having these also deficient.
What's the name of the disease?
No,
the deficiency of the...
We don't, thank God, no doctor put a special name to the disease of this condition. They just say the people who have deficiency of terminal components of the complement protein, they are more vulnerable to the gram-negative bacterial infection, more specifically about Neisseria bacteria. Of course, there are two groups, gonorrhea and gonococci and meningococci. Is that right? Am I clear? But gram-positive bacteria, they handle well. You want to know why? It means killing in gram-positive bacteria through the complement system may not be requiring this thing, even remaining this component up to this can manage the gram positive. Should I tell you how? Okay. Actually, there's one more function of complement system. Up to now, I just told you that complement system in this given example has produced membrane attack complex and damaged the physical integrity of bacterial lipid membranes. Am I clear? But it's not necessary you drill holes into your enemy. Do you think if you tie your enemy with the loin, a loin will eat up the enemy? This is one more way how complement work. Let me tell you how. Let's suppose this is a gram-positive bacteria. Of course, it must be weeping, isn't it? Why? Why? Because complements have attacked. Why? Because antibody bind here. This bacteria is attacked, marked by the antibody. Antibody tail become active. Now you will tell me, who will bind here? C1. And that will activate which one?
C4.
And what will remain there? C4B. And what will go away? C4A. And then what will bind here? C2B. And what will go away? Another apple, which is C2A. Is that right? And these two are called?
C3
converters. So they will activate what? C3B. And what another apple will go away? What is that?
C3A.
Right. Now you can say this bacteria is hooked with C1. Actually, bacteria was chained by the antibody. Tail of the antibody activated C1. C1 bound C4B and 2B, which activated C3B. So all these are sticking to what? Bacteria. Is that right? Now, what happens? That all of them are sticking together on the surface of bacteria. Am I clear? Is that clear? No problem? Now, who are the dangerous loins which eat up the bacteria? Neutrophil then?
Macrophages.
Neutrophil then? Macrophages, they love to eat up bacteria. They eat up the particulate matter, particles. Look, imagine here is a neutrophil or macrophage and it is trying to eat this bacteria. Whenever you try to eat bacteria, bacteria may slip out of its mouth. Is that right? But in it, it has a special pocket with which it can bind with C3B. But there is no complement bind with it. But look at another bacteria. This is a bacteria. This is a bacteria with C14B, 2B, C3B. So C3B is there. Now, okay, A components will go away. Who is here? Macrophage. Actually, this portion of the, this is a special protein which is expressed on the neutrophil then macrophages. And this protein loves to stick with C3B. You get it? So if any bacteria is unfortunately having C3B attached with it, and this touch any neutrophil or macrophage, can this run away? It cannot run away. It's just like that I tie you with a very big dog, with a chain. Chain consists of especially C3B. And now can you run away? Dog is there with you, isn't it? This is a special function of C3B. The C3B has receptors on the neutrophil and macrophage membranes, and whenever neutrophil to macrophage find a bacteria attached with C3B, right? So C3B will activate the receptor. This is called C3B receptor. This gives very powerful signal, gives a very, very happy signal to the macrophage internal site. Congratulations, we have a bacteria which is loaded with C3b, it will never go away, let's grab it. Super opportunity. I say simply, C3b enhances the phagocytosis. Bacteria can be phagocytosed without C3b, but slowly. If there are 10 bacteria here, without C3b, they will be phagocytosed slowly. But if there are 10 more bacteria, and on their surface, what is this? C3b molecules. C3b on one side are holding with the sticking to bacteria, other side they can stick with the neutrophil or macrophage. It is just like bacteria now find, neutrophil or macrophage now find bacteria which are having the jam on it, and they will be eaten up very deliciously. Are you understanding it?
Yes.
Am I clear? So we can say C3b facilitate the phagocytosis of bacteria. Is that right? Any molecule which facilitate the phagocytic process is called opsonin. What is the definition of opsonin? Opsonins are those molecules which on one side can bind with bacteria, on other side can bind with neutrophil or macrophages and hold the bacteria and neutrophil or macrophage together, and they facilitate the process of phagocytosis. So it means opsonin molecules amplify the phagocytic process. One of the opsonin molecules you right now know is C3b. There's one more you are supposed to know.
IgG.
Excellent, IgG. One of the antibody, look here. Now I will tell you something interesting. Let's suppose this is a very happy bacteria. Why? Because it does not have opsonin attached with it. If neutrophil try to eat it, it may fool that. Is that right? And neutrophil is really worried what is happening to it and having a lot of sweat to eat it. Right? Very sad neutrophil. Having tears. Opposite to that, here are two neutrophils which are very, very happy. Is that right? There is one neutrophil here and there is one more neutrophil here. Very, very happy. You know why they are happy? Because this bacteria is very sad. And why this bacteria is very sad? Because it has sticking to it C3b. On one side it stick to bacteria, on other side it's sticking to the neutrophil. So it will be sure eaten up. Another is that another bacteria which does not have C3b but still very sad. Right? Why? Because it has antibody, especially IgG. IgG. IgG on one side bind with the bacteria, other side it tail become active as soon as it bind with the antibody. Either it will activate the complement system or it may interact directly with the receptor of neutrophil or macrophage. And this receptor is for which one? Which molecule? Fc portion of IgG. So it means neutrophil and macrophage have receptor for, neutrophil or macrophage have receptor for C3b receptor, as well as they have receptors for on their surface, Fc portion of IgG, right? So any bacteria which is coated with C3b will be caught very effectively, or any bacteria which is coated with IgG will be caught by these neutrophil or macrophage very effectively. It is not only true about bacteria, even if your RBCs are coated with IgG, they will be very rapidly phagocytosed by macrophages. If your RBCs are coated with IgG molecule, they will be very rapidly phagocytosed by macrophages, and excessive breakdown of RBCs will be pathological hemolysis. Is that right? So if you produce autoantibodies IgG against your own RBC proteins, your RBCs will be very rapidly phagocytosed and you will develop hemolytic anemia. Anemia due to hemolysis, breakdown of the RBCs. Am I clear? So now we can define opsonization. What is opsonization? Opsonization is the process in which opsonin molecule bind on one side to the particulate matter, which may be a bacteria, which may be our tumor cell, or which may be our own cell like RBC. Opsonin molecule on one side bind with particulate matter, and on other side they bind with the receptors on phagocytic cells, and opsonin molecules enhance the phagocytosis of particulate matter. You must know two opsonin molecules, especially C3b and IgG. Am I clear? Now let's see a very interesting thing. How antibodies can kill bacteria? There are so many ways. You know, if wife wants to shout on the husband, she can shout in how many ways? Only husband knows. So many ways. In the same way, when antibodies are going to damage the bacteria, they have so many ways to do it, not only one way. Look, this is a bacteria, this is another bacteria. We'll look at only three ways. What are here? What is this? Yeah, antibodies. Here this antibody wanted in a simple way destroy the bacteria. It never activated the complement. It didn't take help of other community people. Antibody stick with this and just activated the receptor on macrophage. And this bacteria will be very rapidly phagocytosed, and that process will be called direct opsonization, because complements are not involved. Antibody led to the direct opsonization of the bacteria. Is that right? Am I clear? Now, sometimes antibody like to play. How antibody likes to play? This antibody activate complement with it. So it will activate C1, right? Then C2B, C4B, yes. Then 2B, then C3B. Now antibody has partially activated the complement. Then this C3B will stick to the receptor on I think it's not a very decent way to kill the bacteria. Antibody little bit played, activated little bit a series of complement system up to C3B, and then C3B stick to and specially activate the phagocytic cell. Please take it up. Here antibody directly doing, here it is indirectly doing. This is also opsonization. This is opsonization by IgG. This is opsonization by C3B. We say this is direct opsonization and this is indirect opsonization. Indirect opsonization. Am I really clear? Hans, understanding it? I'm so impressed, but not surprised. I know you understand sometimes. Now, sometimes antibodies say, okay, I don't want to take the help of. Antibody decide that it does not want to take help of neutrophils, right? It just want to take the help of complement. Antibody bind with the bacteria, and it is a very cruel way to kill. Now it will activate C1, 4B, 2B, both of them act as C3, convertase. Then they activate, it was here C3B. So what is this here? 3B, and then activate C5B, 6, 7, 8, 9, and all of them make a membrane attack complex, and this antibody keep on moving its tail, and there this series remain active and keep on producing this terminal membrane attack complex. One membrane attack complex fall down, another C5 come, and again another attack complex form, so multiple holes are produced, right? It must be also very, very sad. Now you see how antibodies can kill bacteria. They can kill bacteria by direct opsonization. They can kill bacteria by indirect opsonization, or they can kill bacteria by activating the complements up to the terminal level until they produce multiple membrane attack complex and produce multiple holes. Am I clear? Let's recap what we were discussing. We have just discussed that there is a bacteria which was expressing antigens, and immune system has made specific antibodies against these antigens. If these antibodies belong to the group of class of IgG or IgM, once the antibody binds with the antigen, Fc portion of the antibody is activated, which activate which protein? Complement number 1. Complement number 1, once it is activated, it hydrolytically break down complement number 4 and 2. Complement number 4 break down into A and B component. In the same way, complement number 2, C2 protein, also break down component A and B. B component remains bound with the whole chain, but A components go away. A for away, A for apple, apples are lost, right? Then what we discussed, that 4B and 2B up to this, right, they are as C3 convertase. They will activate the C3 protein or C3 complement, and again A component of C3 is broken away and B component remain bound. Then what we discussed, C4B, 2B and C3B together, all of them make C5 convertase. C5 convertase is the power to break down C5 and convert into active form into B and A and B. A diffuses away and C5B remains bound, and up to this, these were early events. Late events are C5B, you know, C5B is part of late event, up to this point is early. C5B will complex with C6, C7 and then 8 and 9, and all these 5 proteins, they make a pentameric hole, perforating pore, and this pore will be planted into bacterial membranes as membrane attack complex and destroy the bacteria, right? Now, this pathway of activating the complement system is called classical pathway. It is a classical pathway of activating the complement, right? One way to remember, you know, General Motors company, GM, they make classical cars. Right, so we can say, everyone remember, GM makes classic car, or you can simply say that IgG and IgM, IgG and IgM activate classical pathway. Is that clear? So this was one way to activate the complement system, right? But for this pathway, you need antibodies. If you do not have antibodies, you cannot activate the complement system through this pathway. Can you? You cannot. But when bacteria comes to your body, it takes about 2 weeks to make enough antibodies to activate the complements and activate the classical pathway and to kill the bacteria. So can it be a first line of defense against bacteria? No. Because when bacteria first time enters into your body, do you have already antibodies?
No.
No, and it takes 1-2 weeks to produce antibodies. And if you really want to attack on the bacteria with the complements, as soon as bacteria come in your body, can you depend on antibodies?
No.
So there must be some other pathways to activate the complement system in which antibodies are not involved, and of course they are not classical pathways. Let me tell you some other ways in which, as soon as bacteria enters in our body, complements start coming in touch with the surface of the bacteria and start getting activated. Is that right? What is that pathway? Let me show you another pathway of activation of complements. In that pathway, there are some certain surface molecules on virus envelope, or some surface molecules on fungal cell wall, or there are some surface molecule on bacterial surface, they can activate the complements. Complements can be directly activated when they come in touch with virus envelope, viral envelopes, or fungal cell walls or bacterial surface molecules. Let's take example of bacteria. This bacteria has just entered into your body and it has entered first time. When it has entered first time, do you think you have the antibodies against it? No. But it may have some certain surface feature. For example, gram-negative bacteria have a special type of protein on their surface. Rather a special lipopolysaccharide complex, which is called endotoxins. Endotoxins are special surface molecules present on the surface of gram-negative bacteria. Usually they are absent on the surface of gram-positive bacteria. And endotoxins are structurally a complex of lipid and carbohydrate. That is why endotoxins are endotoxins. Endotoxins are called lipopolysaccharide, lipids with multiple saccharides. Let's suppose that this is endotoxin or some other surface molecule. Now, these lipopolysaccharides or endotoxin molecules are present on the surface of which bacteria, gram-positive or gram-negative? Gram-negative especially. In the same way, series some molecules similar to this, not exactly, are present on fungus or viral envelope. They are not lipopolysaccharide, but they can work like lipopolysaccharide to activate the complement. What really happens, as soon as this bacteria enters in our body and start damaging the tissue, inflammatory response start around it, blood vessels start dilating and endothelial cells shrink and complements will come out. Right? When complements will come and touch it, now something very important, that complement number 3 will directly touch it and become active. Look at it. This is complement number 3. And of course, as soon as it becomes active, it loses the? Which component? C3A. Later on, I will tell you the functions of A components later on. Right? And what is this now? C3B. So we can say there are certain surface molecules or virus envelope or fungal cell membranes or bacterial surfaces, there are some molecules on which as soon as C3 touches it, it breaks down into A and B components. Am I clear? So what has become active? C3B. Now, again, once C3B is activated by the surface molecule, right, it will make a domain which will react with another protein, and that protein, the second protein, it has also lost the apple. This protein is called, its name is B name. So protein B, again, thank God, maybe they could call this Waldemar protein or some difficult name. Thank God they just call it B protein. Of course, not baby, B protein. And B protein, when it touch the C3B, it also break down into BA and BB. It's difficult to understand. So, on the surface of the bacteria, there are certain molecules which activate C3B. C3B activate B protein and break down into BB and BA component. A goes away. Now, what is this complex called? C3B? BB. What is the name of this complex? These two things together? C3B. These together can activate one more C3B. This is acting as C3 convertase. These two together are acting as C3 convertase. Is that right? And these C3 convertase molecule, right, which is C3BB, right, this will bind one more C3, and that C3 will again lose an apple. What is this? C3A, and what will be left behind? C3B. Now, these two together were called C3 convertase. But now these one more C3B together, all of this is called C5 convertase. What is this? C5 convertase. Is that right? Again, let's remember what was there? Surface molecule. What bound? C3B. Then B, B, both of them together. C3 convertase, then another C3B, and now together called C5 convertase. And then remaining story is the same, that what will bind here? C5B, and what will go away? C5A. C5B, remaining story is same. 6, 7, 8, 9 going to attack. So terminal pathway is same in previous. Now C5B, 6, 7, 8, 9. All these complexes same as in classical pathway. So this is called final common pathway. C5B, 6, 7, 8, 9 was present in the previous pathway as well as in this pathway. So this is final common pathway in both activation. But initial steps are different. But both pathways produce C5 convertase before they activate the final events. Am I clear? So this pathway is called, of course it is not classical pathway. It is an alternative way to activate the complement system. So again, thank God they did not put a funny name to it. They simply call it alternate pathway. Alternate pathway of activating complements. That's so simple. So how many pathways you know now? Classical pathway and alternate pathway. What is the difference? Which is more when bacteria first time come in touch with your surfaces? Alternate pathway is activated or classical pathway is activated?
Alternate
pathway. Which is more important as first line of defense? Alternate pathway. First line of defense when bacteria come in your body is alternate pathways. And look, when bacteria enter, which will be first activated? Alternate pathway. And once antibodies are activated, produced, then which pathway can be activated? Classical pathway. Are you clear? Now, you can compare it. It's so simple. This is one bacterium. This is another bacterium. Now, if this is the antigen, here is also antigen. Is that right? You have to tell me, what is this pathway? Antibody? C1? Yes, you tell me.
4?
2? 3. What is this?
C3
convertase. Then?
3.
Of course, B. Babies remain there. Apples go away. Now it's together. What is this?
C5
convertase. And then what is it? 5B, 6, 7, 8, 9. Clear? Now you look at this. Suppose endotoxins. What is first?
C3.
B. Then what is binding?
BB.
Then what is there?
C3B.
Now, these two together were convertase, and all of them are?
C5.
I think you know complement system too well. I don't know who taught you. Now, what is this?
C5B.
B, then?
6, 7, 8, 9.
7. Oh, you know counting. Good. 9. Right? Now, this pathway here and here, this is what is that? What is that it called? Final common pathway. Or terminal events or late events in complement activation. So this is classical pathway. This is
alternate pathway.
This is activated later once antibodies are produced against the bacteria. This is activated immediately as soon as bacteria invade your body. Right? This pathway is dependent on presence of IgG, IgM. This pathway is activated without antibodies. This pathway involves C1, that pathway does not involve C142. So classical pathway activate C142, right? And in classical pathway, C3 convertase is antigen, antibody, C1. They are the initial event. Then they activate C4 and C2. C4 and C2, C4B and C2B are the C3 convertase of classical pathway. But C3B, BB are the
C3 convertase
of alternate pathway. Is that right? Then, of course, C3B will bind here as well as there. This whole complex will become C5 convertase. These will become also C5 convertase. And then final common pathway. Is it difficult to understand? It's easy, isn't it? It's dangerously easy. Okay. So this was another. Then there's one more way they have discovered recently. There is one more way some bacteria can activate the complement system. Is that right? What is that? Actually, they found sometimes bacteria can activate the complements on the surface, right, without having antibodies and even without having endotoxins, because endotoxins are present on gram
negative.
But sometimes complements are directly activated on the surface of gram positive also. So then they were thinking, and there was no antibody. They said on gram positive bacteria, if complements are directly activating and there is no antibody, it cannot be classical. And if there is no endotoxin, this cannot be alternate. There must be something else. Now they know it. That on some bacterial surface or many bacterial surface, they are having a special molecule which is called menin. What is the name of this molecule? Menin molecules. Menin molecules. Is that right? Now, actually, from our blood, a special type of protein which is normally present, that is called menin binding lectin. That comes from there. And that loves to bind with menin. And this protein is named in a very simple way, not called protein Abdul or protein Hassan. No, very simple name. Menin binding lectins. This belong to a group of lectins. So menin binding lectin proteins are normally present in our blood. And as soon as this protein bind with surface molecules of menin on the surface of certain bacteria, these proteins become active. And they activate certain proteolytic enzyme. They activate certain proteolytic enzymes. And these proteolytic enzymes, which are activated by menin-binding lectins, they actually, now you know what will happen, they actually, yes, they break down C4 into, what is binding here? C4B, and which will go away? C4A. And they can also activate, what is this? C2B, and what is lost there?
C2A.
What is this produced? Please tell me. Yes, C3 convertase. Like the C3 convertase of classical pathway. But we cannot call it classical pathway because it does not have antibodies. It does not have C1. Is that right? Remaining events are like classical pathway. You know, once C3 convertase is there, of course it will activate which one? C3B. And now the apple which has gone out, fragment which has gone away, C3A. Remaining story, I think, must be clear to you people. What is there? Yeah? C5, B, 6, 7, 8, 9. Final common pathway. Look at. Now compare and contrast. This was your classical pathway. Classical pathway of complement activation. This was your
alternate
pathway of complement activation. And what is this? Yeah, very easy. Menin binding lectin pathway, or lectin pathway simply. Lectin pathway of complement activation. So now you have three pathways. They have something common. What is the common? They have a common final pathway. That all of them produce membrane attack complex, but in early steps they differ from each other. Is that right? Now, already you know classical pathway is activated only when you have antibodies against bacteria. Especially which group? IgG and IgM. Is that right? Those classes of antibodies. Alternate pathway is activated when antibody even are not present. Without the presence of antibodies, alternate pathway can be activated as a first line of defense. Just some proteins stretch the surface and complement system is activated. Right? What do you think in this case? Antibodies are involved?
No.
No. So, when bacteria come in your body, they are this pathway is activated early or late?
Early.
Because we don't need antibodies. Antibody takes time to build up. But menin is exposed on the surface of bacteria, and menin binding proteins are normally present in our blood. Do you get it? Is that right? And of course, this pathway is acting like innate immune response. Innate immune responses, which is non-specifically activated against multiple organisms and which is present naturally in your body and which with repeated exposure which does not boost up. That is called innate immunity. So this is an example of innate immunity, and this is also an example of innate immunity. Your skin provides innate immunity. Skin is normally present either bacteria come or not, and repeated attack of bacteria will not increase the skin to augment, I hope. Is that right? So this is example of innate. In the same way, this pathway alternate, and this is example of innate. This is dependent on antibodies, and antibodies are acquired after the exposure to the antigen or bacteria. So this is helping, this part of the complement system is helping the acquired immunity. Now look, do you think immune system will work well without complement proteins? No. So it means complement proteins augment the function of immune system. Or complement proteins complement the function of immune system. Is that clear? Okay. We have talked about that what are the function of C5B, 6, 7, 8, 9. They will produce perforations. Is that right? But we have also talked about C3B, which act as what kind of molecule?
Opsonin
molecule. But we did not talk about all this huge group of A. Apples are also doing certain functions. Should I tell you? You want to really know?
Yes.
That these broken fragments are really useful or not? These broken hearts also do some functions. Right? Let me tell you what they do. We will make a simple diagram. That when there is bacteria present in your body and they are damaging the tissue, of course there is some inflammatory and immune response produced, complement system is activated, and breakdown products of the complement proteins are produced at the site of inflammation and at the site of infection, of course. Clear? We'll see what they are doing. Let's take an example. This was a bacteria. Okay, we just take an example that these fragments are produced during classical activation. This is the antigen. What should be this?
Antibody.
And what is this? Active tail of antibody. Just rapidly tell me, what will be this?
C1.
And now you tell me, what is C1? No, I will put it here. What is this?
C4B.
And what has gone away?
C4A.
And then what is it? 2B. And what has gone away?
2A.
Of course, C2A. Then both of them were acting as? Yes, please, hurry up.
C3
convertase. So which apple has gone now?
C3A.
Now whole of it is? C5 convertase. So which has been activated and put there? And which apple has gone?
C5A.
And of course, remaining story is not difficult. Yes, 6, 7, 8, 9. Am I clear? Membrane attack complex. Now we'll see what are the functions of these proteins. Right? They do also have a functions. Right? And what are the functions done by them? You remember there was blood vessel vascular system here, right? And every connective tissue in your body has mast cells. You know mast cells? Mast cells are connective tissue cells, right? So this is connective tissue area. So there must be some very special cells here, which are called, we say mast cells, right? Mast cells have a nucleus, of course. With that, they have many granules which are loaded with histamine and proteolytic enzymes. You know it? Serotonin, these are the granules of the mast cells. Am I right? There are many things which can activate the mast cell. Everyone knows IgE can activate the mast cells, right? Physical trauma can activate the mast cells. Ultraviolet light can activate the mast cells. Thermal trauma can activate the mast cells, right? Microbiological injury can activate the mast cells. Radiation can activate the mast cells. So mast cells are present throughout your connective tissue. And any type of injury, they are very, very sensitive cells. Touch me not. They're very, very sensitive cells. Any type of injury can activate the mast cells, and mast cells start producing prostaglandins and leukotrienes, and they start releasing histamine, and all these things start the process of inflammation. That is why you injure here, inflammation will start. That is why you give thermal injury, inflammation will start. You give radiation injury, inflammation will start. Even you insect bite, insect venom can activate mast cells. And mast cell produce their products and start the inflammation. But right now, what is important for this? Mast cell, I told you, is very, very sensitive. So it means it should have receptors for so many things. And it should have a very, very sensitive membrane. The little change and injury, they become active. The very important news right now is, mast cells are also sensitive to the apples. They are having receptors for these apples. Especially C3A and C5A. They are having receptors. Mast cell surface have receptor for, yes please. I don't know how to make apple. I think kids know how to. Okay, this is apple. What is this? C5A. And there is another receptor. These are proteins which are normally present on the surface of mast cells. And this is a receptor for? C3A. Right, this can fit over there. C3A. So what really happens? When bacteria start producing injury, and once the complements are activated by any pathway, if there is lot of C3A product and C3A and C5A product produced, they can simply activate the mast cells. And when local mast cells are activated, they produce more?
Yes.
Histamine. And other vasoactive products. This histamine will produce vasodilatation. So more blood come into this area to fight. Maybe more blood mean more neutrophil. More monocytes which will come into convert into macrophage. More blood mean more antibodies. More blood mean more complements coming to this area. And then histamine act on endothelial cells. So endothelial cell shrink. And all these things like complement proteins and antibody can ooze out. So it means that once complement are activated and complement produce C3 and C3A and C5A product, through the mast cell activation, they amplify the inflammatory response. They produce vasodilatation and they produce increased permeability. So we can say C3A and C5A are not the lost apples. These are the biologically active products. They act as, yes, inflammatory response amplifier. It means these fragments of the complement activation amplify or augment the inflammatory response. Or simply we say, these fragments of the complement protein complement inflammatory response. So now you understand that these complement proteins, once they are activated, they complement the functions of the immune system as well as they complement the inflammatory response. Am I clear? Is it good or bad? It is good, of course. Apples are never bad until they are rotten. Now, C3A and C5A can activate mast cell. C5A has one more function. C5A has one more function. You know what is the function of it? On neutrophil surface, there are receptors for C5a. Neutrophil can smell where are the apples and start running in the direction of that. Look, here's a neutrophil which has just come out. This is the neutrophil. On the surface of the neutrophil, thank you. On the surface of the neutrophil, there are many receptors for C5a. And now, look, if neutrophil has come out, C5a will load here. But if there is a blood vessel here and neutrophil has come out from here, do you think which side of the neutrophil will be overloaded with the, which receptors will be loaded? Receptor facing towards the inflammation to the complement system or away? So they will be loaded. So this, when these receptors, receptor for sensing C5a, when these receptors are activated, they give signal that on this side probably there is some game going on. It starts slipping into this side. This will start slipping to this side. And look here, if there is some blood vessel here, right, and some neutrophil come from here, of course neutrophil should move towards site of injury. So receptors are present throughout, everywhere. But these receptors will be activated which face the injury. So they will give signal and it will start. So it is just like this, that I don't have eyes, but if someone touch my skin here, if I'm the neutrophil and you touch an apple here, what's the name of apple?
C5A.
You touch the apple here, I start slipping this side. If you touch apple here, I start slipping this side. Isn't it beautiful? That when there is inflammation going on, injury going on, C5A is being generated there. Number one, during this activation, we are ruthlessly killing bacteria and still complement system is not satisfied. It's very sadistic. It is producing C5A, go and bring more neutrophil to kill this bacteria. Meanwhile, C5A is also going and enhancing vascular event so that more neutrophil and antibodies and complement come. We are not as simple as I look or you look. We are quite complicated, isn't it? And we should be thankful to nature that all these things happen automatically. We have to just pass step one. If you have to control how the neutrophil should drive, I think there will be a lot of trouble. Maybe someday you are sleeping and you forget that for the infection you have to activate the neutrophil. Yeah. Or thank God, many things in nature happen automatically. You breathe automatically. Otherwise you forget to breathe. Maybe you are too much concentrating on some girl. That is very dangerous. Or you are sleeping and you forget to breathe. It will be a tragedy. So there are so many things which are automatically working, right? Including the business of activating complements. Is that right? Yes, come back. So now you understand, C3A act as mast cell activator. C5A also act as mast cell activator. These products produce reaction like anaphylaxis, local anaphylaxis. So we call them, these molecules, these apples, C3A and C5A, which act as mast cell activators, right? These are all, these molecules are also called anaphylatoxin. Anaphylatoxin. So anaphylatoxins are produced during complement activation. What are these products? These are C5A and C3A. C3A and C5A. Plus, it can attract neutrophils. They enhance the directional movement of neutrophil. Right? This process is called chemotaxis. Chemicals are producing taxi of the neutrophil activity. Neutrophil act like a taxi and smell certain, sense certain molecules and move. So we can say that C5A act as anaphylatoxins, plus it act as chemotactic agent for especially neutrophil. Even very recently they have discovered C5A has receptors on endothelium. And endothelial cell under the influence of this apple, C5A, start expressing more receptor for neutrophil and monocytes. So that neutrophil which are passing from this side to that side, they should not pass away. They should stick here and come out. So they enhance the adhesiveness of endothelial lining to the inflammatory cells. Is it augmenting or cancelling the effect of inflammation?
Augmenting.
Right? Then, not only these functions, there is another very interesting function, that is that C1, 4, 2 and 3, some of the product can neutralize viruses. Do you have a concept of virus is neutralized? When we say the virus is neutralized, what does it mean? Its charges are neutralized or what happened? Have you heard this term? That and exotoxins are neutralized or virus is neutralized by immune components? If you know something, you can tell me.
Inactivated?
Inactivated. What way?
Yeah,
very good. That if we say that a chemical substance neutralizes virus, that is very true. That inactivate virus. Which activity of the virus is inactivated?
It's dormant.
No, before you tell me something new.
Replication?
Look, just a minute. Before you tell me totally new theory, look. Suppose this is a cell. You know, hepatitis B virus specially attack which cells? Liver cells. Is that right? Let's suppose this is a virus which is... This virus is hepatotropic virus, a virus which loves to attack hepatocytes. Why this virus specifically attack hepatocyte? Maybe this virus has special surface proteins and these proteins have some complementary proteins here on hepatocytes. But these proteins are not present in other tissues. So virus will stick to these cells and enter into these cells, virus will not enter into other tissues. So it means why some virus attack a special type of tissue, some virus attack skin, other virus attack brain, some virus attack liver and some virus attack multiple tissue, why? It depends on what are the surface proteins present on the virus and with which cells virus can stick and then virus get internalized. Because virus has to stick and then virus has to go into cell, then it will multiply and then it will be able to produce some damaging effect on the body. Am I right? If virus keep on moving outside, it will be taken away. You are understanding? It's too dangerous at midnight moving on the roads. Same is true about the virus. It should enter into house and multiply there. If it keep on moving outer side, maybe it will be taken away by maybe neutrophils or macrophages or antibodies. Look, let's a simple example. This is a virus.
So
antibody bind with it. Antibody tail become active. You tell me, what is this process? Yes, opsonization. Virus may be opsonized. So virus love to, before they get opsonized, they love to enter into cellular houses where antibodies cannot enter into cell. Is that right? But if there is some chemical substance or immune system produces a product and that product stick on this area, do you think now virus can enter into cell?
No.
And can it produce disease?
No.
The pathogenic effect of the virus is neutralized. The power of the virus to damage our tissue is neutralized. Is that right? Some complement can work like this. That when virus enter into your body, they are just moving into body fluids and looking for the chances to enter into target tissue. Before they really get a chance to enter into cell, some of these complement factors, maybe this is C1, maybe this is C4, maybe this is C2, maybe this is C3. And when they will cover these proteins, can virus stick to this and enter?
No.
So it is moving about, it cannot enter, but it is moving into body fluids. And body fluids are very hostile for things like this. Some neutrophil or macrophage will come and take it away. Do you understand it? This is called neutralization of the virus. That capacity of virus to enter into cell and multiply and produce damage to our body is neutralized. Am I clear? So some of the complement factors act as viral neutralizing proteins. Virus neutralizing proteins. Now you see that complement factors can neutralize the viruses. Complement factor can act as anaflatoxins. Complement factors can act as chemotactic agent. Complement factors can act as cytolytic product, membrane attack complex, and then one more thing. You know from where the antibodies are produced in our body? Which cells produce antibodies? Which cells in our body produce antibodies? Of course, B cell, but don't tell anyone B cell. It is answer of a good doctor, but excellent doctor will say active B cell, which are called plasma cells. You see, this is a B cell. It is activated by, usually by T helper 1. No, sorry, corrected, T helper 2. They produce the product like interleukin 4 and interleukin 5, which convert B cell into plasma cells, and these plasma cells start secreting antibodies, and these antibodies will run the business in a dangerous fashion for bacteria. Am I clear? No problem? B cells have receptors for what is this thing? C3b. Some of these C3b break away and it may bind here. And once this is a receptor for C3b and this receptor is present on B cell, when this receptor is activated, give powerful stimulation to the genetic material of B cell, and under the special stimulatory action of C3b, B cell massively proliferate and plasma cells are produced less or more. So antibodies are produced more. That means this fragment of the complement system act as antibody producing amplifier. It amplifies the antibody production in your body, because they have seen the patient who do not have C3b molecules, they produce antibodies but with low levels. Is that right? So it means that complement proteins are doing so many functions, and you see they are doing many functions related with the immune system. Like complements are enhancing the power of antibodies to destroy the bacteria. Complement this specially can enhance the power of B cell to produce antibodies. Right? These are their complementary action to the immune system. And they can produce, activate mast cells, produce mediators of inflammation, produce vasodilation, increase permeability, increase chemotaxis, increase adhesiveness of endothelial lining to the white cells, increase chemotaxis. Even increase phagocytosis by C3b opsonizing function. So it means complement proteins augment not only the immune system, but also augment the function of inflammatory system. Is that clear? Right, lectures, we have already discussed that how the complement system work, how it can be activated, is that right? And now we will be talking about that how complement system is biologically regulated in our body, because complement products and system should not be abnormally and unduly activated in a healthy person. It should only be activated when there is need of stimulation or help of immune system, or we need augmentation to the inflammatory reaction. So first we'll repeat just few steps how complement system is activated, rather you will tell me, you have studied that in the last lecture, and then we'll talk about regulation. So you will tell me how the classical pathway is activated. If this is the bacteria, this is the antigen, right? If this is classic pathway, which antibodies should be there? What type of antibodies should be there? IgG and yes, IgG and IgM. Right? General Motors, IgG, IgM, right? So once these antibodies present with the antigen, Fc portion of antibodies activated, and this start activating the complement through classic pathway. In classic pathway, yes, which complement factor is first of all activated? C1. And then activated C1 will activate which complement? Yes?
C4.
C4 will lose one part. What is that? C4A, and part which remains behind is C4B. Now C4B will activate the another complement, the next one, which is that one? C2. It will lose which part? C2A, and which part remains behind? C2B. You remember B for binding. So always remember B part remain bound with the main system. I told you in the last lecture, these are the apples which go away, babies remain there. Babies lose the apples. Babies mean B parts, which are staying there. A mean apples are losing. So in classical pathway, we discussed antibody activates C1, C1 activates C4, and break down C4 into A and B. A is into fluid form, fluid phase lost, and B remain there, which activate
C2.
You should tell me, I have given the lecture, and C2, B remain there, and what is lost? C2, A. And both of them together are called
C3 convertase.
They are called C3 convertase enzyme. Now, after that, there is a central molecule which is stimulated. What is that central molecule?
C3.
It fragments into two parts. Apple goes away. What goes away? C3?
A.
What remains behind?
C3B.
And this complex, which include all this, it means it include C4B plus C2B plus C3B. All these three together, what are they called?
C5 convertase.
So they are called C5 convertase, right? C5 convertase binds with, yes, C5 convertase will activate which and product? Now C5. Again, which will be lost? Apple. C5A. What is left behind? C5B. Is that right? Then, yes. What will be activated next?
C6, 7, 8, and 9.
And C5 to C9 whole this complex is called membrane attack complex. That is called good. Membrane attack complex. And this will attack the membranes of the bacteria and produce perforation, and bacteria will be dead. Am I clear? This is one pathway. Of course, it's very logical that it should be only activated when there is need of it, because if it is unduly activated, such product will be produced in the body and they may damage our own tissue. Or if this is unduly activated, inappropriately activated, these products are produced which will activate the mast cells and unduly produce inflammation. Or if they are unduly activated, this will not only activate the mast cell, C5A will also attract neutrophils and undue neutrophilic activity. Is that right? So they should be only activated when there is a need. We'll talk about their regulation. This was classic pathway. Then we have discussed in the last lecture another pathway which was called alternate pathway. In alternate pathway, we discussed that IgG and IgM are involved or not involved? They are not involved. That is why they are not classical pathway. They are not General Motors. They don't make classical cars, right? Now, in alternate pathway, what really happens? In alternate pathway, there are some molecules on the surface of bacteria or surface of virus or surface of fungus which can directly activate the complement system. Especially endotoxins present on the surface of gram-negative bacteria. Endotoxins which are present on the surface of gram-negative bacteria, they can activate alternate pathway. Another thing, alternate pathway can also be activated by aggregated IgA. If there are many IgA molecules which are making a clump and aggregation and deposited on some surface, they can activate alternate pathway. You may be thinking that why I'm stressing this point. Let me tell you, in some diseases, IgA aggregates are formed in our body and they are not removed. So classical pathway will be unduly alternate pathway will be unduly activated and tissue will be damaged. Do you know some disease like this?
No.
There is a disease which is called IgA nephropathy. Have you heard the name of it? Or it is also called Berger disease? IgA nephropathy. In these patients, IgA aggregates are moving in the blood and they get stuck with the mesangium in the glomeruli. And glomerular mesangium, they get adherent to that. And when a lot of IgA aggregates bind with the mesangial deposit there, alternate pathway will be activated on the glomerular structure. And if that is activated in the glomerular structure, those inflammatory reactions will damage the glomeruli and produce proteinuria and hematuria. And we call the person is having Berger disease or IgA nephropathy. Am I clear?
Yes.
Is that right? There is another disease in which IgA aggregates are accumulated under the skin and in the GIT, and there's inappropriate activation of alternate pathway under the skin and in GIT mucosa. So there are skin lesions with GIT dysfunction. If you tell me the name of the disease, I can offer you $100 because luckily today I have. Someone paid me right now. Who likes to have $100? You likes to have, but you have to give the answer also. Okay, let's have this. If you give the right answer, I give you $100. And if you give wrong answer, you give me $100. IgA aggregates present in GIT mucosa and under the skin and inappropriately activating the complement system alternate pathway and producing a disease. Yes. Yes, no idea. Dermatitis herpetiformis. You never heard of it. Dermatitis, inflammation of skin. And initially it was wrongly thought that it is due to herpes. So it was given a name, dermatitis herpetiformis. Right? Okay, I'll give you another disease in which IgA aggregates deposit in body. I just, by the way, remember in this lecture. Right? That IgA aggregates move in the body and they are not cleared. And they deposit into multiple tissues in the body. Let me tell you. Some of them deposit in the GIT. And usually child develops abdominal cramps. Some of them develop into synovial membrane, polyarthritis. Some of them develop under the skin, skin rashes. Some of those deposits develop in the glomeruli, proteinuria. Some of them develop, those deposits develop in the lymph nodes, lymphadenopathy. You have to tell me diagnosis. Okay, I will put the classical clinical situation. 7-year-old child had 1 or 2 weeks back upper respiratory tract viral infection. After that, he developed fever with abdominal pain, rashes especially on lower limbs, polyarthritis, proteinuria, generalized lymphadenopathy. Please tell me the answer. Even some pleuritic pain, and to be very classical, pericardial pain also sometimes. Have you heard of Heno-Scholin purpura? Never heard of things like this. You never go beyond ischemic heart disease. Heno-Scholin purpura. Right? In this condition, what happens? IgA, the person developed first, baby developed first, viral infection, respiratory tract. And you know mucosal antibodies are IgA. IgA is the antiseptic paint on the mucosa. So when he developed the respiratory viral infection, he made a lot of IgA. But in this baby, IgA clearance mechanism was not good. So IgA, which was spilled into blood, made aggregate and could not be cleared. Normally, it is the duty of the liver to remove liver. It is duty of the liver to remove the IgA aggregates from the blood. So these aggregated IgA deposited in multiple areas when they developed under the skin. Complement stimulated inflammatory lesions, rashes. When these deposits develop in the GIT mucosa, abdominal cramps. When these deposits were there in producing inflammatory lesion in glomeruli, what was there? Proteinuria. Is that right? When these deposits are caught into lymph node, generalized lymphadenopathy, it's so easy to explain. Such deposits love to bind with pleural membrane and pericardial membrane, so sometimes they may develop pleuritic pain and pericardial pain. Is that right? And in few days, liver will eventually remove these IgA aggregates and baby will be okay. And after a few months, he again developed the respiratory tract infection. And again, that is followed by all these things. Is that right? So Heno-Scholin purpura. This is another dysfunction that IgA aggregates were not removed from the blood. Am I clear? Right? Now, let's talk about how alternate pathway was activated. We were discussing it last time, and this is suppose endotoxins or IgA aggregates, right? Now, who will bind here directly? Yes. Do you think you need IgG, IgM? No. In this case, what will bind here? C3B will be there, and what will be left away? C3A. Is that right? Now, C3A goes away, C3B is deposited here. And with deposited C3B, another protein comes and binds. What is that protein? Yeah, that is called, very simple name, B factor. B factor. And as soon as B factor touches, it breaks down to B A factor and B B factor. So what remains there with this B B factor? What is the loss here? B A factor. These two together act as C3 convertase. So they activate one more molecule of C3. So what is there? Yeah, another C3B deposited. C3B deposited. And what has gone away? C3A. Is that right? Now all three together act as C5 convertase, and they activate C5, and what is lost? C5A. What is left behind? C5B. And what will bind with it? 6, 7, 8, and 9. And they will make perforations and kill the bacteria. Am I clear? So this was your classic pathway. This is your alternate path. We know the pathways. Now we have to see how they are regulated. This is the real topic which I wanted to discuss. How they are regulated. The very first factor for regulation of especially classic pathway is the presence of antibody. Presence of antibodies. If antibodies are not there, can classic be activated?
No.
If antibodies level is high in a particular area, complement production and activation will be
high.
More. And if antibody level in some tissue is less?
Less.
So one of the very important factor for classic pathway activation is that IgG, IgM should be there, or any one of these two should be there. Secondly, not only IgG, IgM should be there, but it should be complexing with the antigen, because normally IgG, IgM is circulating in the blood without activating the complement, thank God. But as soon as, and these antibodies are like dogs, they keep on moving, but as soon as they get the bone, they start moving the tail, and tail activates the complement system. So these antibodies, IgG and IgM, are circulating in the blood, but if antibodies are not having the antigens, they are unable to activate the complement, thank God. They don't activate. But as soon as these circulating antibodies reach to a point where there are antigens, as soon as antibody, this is antibody without antigen, this is the antibody complex with antigen. As soon as antibody complex with the antigen, IgG, IgM, this portion become active. This is the part which can activate the complement. So what does it mean? Another factor which controls the activation of classic pathway is the presence of antigen-antibody complex, not just antibody. Is that right? These two very logical things which are required for activation of the classic pathway. Then there is a very special regulator. What is that regulator? As I told you, that in classic pathway, this is the antigen. Here is suppose antibody, right? And this antibody is complexing with the antigen. And I told you in the previous lecture that as soon as antibody react with the antigens, it exposes certain areas. These are the areas, and these areas are able to react with C1. Is that right? Let's suppose C1 bind here. What is this binding here? C1. And what is here binding? C1. Am I clear? Now, as soon as C1 start binding here, it activates its proteolytic activity. What is this? Proteolytic activity. Is that right? But there is an enzyme present in the blood, and this enzyme is called, yes, this is not happy with this activity business, this is called, yes, C1 esterase inhibitor. What is this? This black enzymes or black proteins inhibit the activity of C1. So they are positively regulating system or negatively regulating?
Negative
regulators. So all of us, thank God, have sufficient amount of C1 inhibitors or C1 esterase inhibitor, so that there should not be inappropriate activation of classic pathway. Is that right? To really activate the classic pathway, there should be so much C1 activated that C1 inhibitor should be overwhelmed. Let me repeat it. If really there's a lot of antigen and there's severe stimulation and the antibodies, then antibodies will produce so much C1 that they will overwhelm their or overcome their inhibitor. Only then pathway can move forward. So it means there should be lot of C1 so that first it inhibit the, neutralize the C1 inhibitor. Only then it can activate the pathway. So we can say that C1 esterase inhibitor, C1 esterase inhibitor is the negative regulator of C1. Now you may be thinking, why Dr. Najib is so concerned about this, that your students should know that there is an inhibitor? Because their disease is related with that. There's a disease, you will tell me the name of the disease, I tell you the condition. In that disease, there's inherited defect, genetic defect. And person does not make C1 inhibitor in sufficient amount. So person is deficient in C1 inhibitor. So such person who has deficiency of C1 inhibitor activity, classic pathway will be underactivated or overactivated? Overactivated, very natural. It's like a car without brakes. When classic pathway is overactivated, then C2A, 4A, 3A, 5A, all these are produced more or less? Yes, they produce more. And if all these products are produced more, you know, these products can activate the mast cells. Mast cells have receptor for C3A, they have receptors for C5A, mast cells are sensitive to even C4A, and when these things touch the mast cells start producing histamine and other product. So it means the person who has inherited deficiency of C1 esterase, he has unfortunately producing overproduction of the product of classic pathway, which may stimulate the mast cells, especially under the skin and under the mucosa. Because under the skin, mast cells are very abundantly present normally. And under the GIT mucosa and other mucosal lining, mast cells are present normally, physiologically, abundantly. So in such patient, mast cells inappropriately are stimulated under the skin and under the GIT mucosa. And what is there? They produce a lot of histamine and other product. And these product of mast cell will produce vasodilation and increase permeability. You know, endothelial cells shrink in microcirculation. So there will be edema of the mucosal membranes and edematous and reddish lesion under the skin. Is that right? Especially these patients sometimes develop very severe edematous swelling of lips, nasal mucosa. Some of them develop so severe swelling of laryngeal mucosa, even they asphyxiate and die. Right? Very special thing about this is that these type of rashes don't itch. They are not itchy, they are not pruritic. Right? This is a rare condition, but very interesting that some people have inherited defect, unfortunately, of C1 inhibitors. So C1 activity in their body is inappropriately more, and under certain stresses they inappropriately activate the products of classic pathway, and that produces severe edematous and inflammatory layer in the mucosal membrane and skin. What is the name of the condition? Yes, I think I will give only $0.50, please. I think you seem to know the answer. Yes.
Is there any hepatic edema?
No, $10 fine. Yes. Who will tell me the name of the condition? C1 esterase inhibitor, very hot question in USMLE. They love to answer this thing. What is the condition? It is called, when I will tell you, you say, yes, you heard it somewhere. This condition is called Gavin. Before you tell me something which no one knows in the world, I must answer. The condition is called angioneurotic edema. Yeah, right, angioneurotic edema. You must be thinking, why it is called neurotic? Because sometimes it is precipitated under anxiety. So people thought maybe it is due to some neurotic dysfunction. Is that right? Later on, now we know what's wrong with these people. Thank God this dysfunction is very rare. But it classically highlights how important is C1 inhibitor. So one of the regulator for the very early step of classic pathway is C1 inhibitor, and now you know the deficiency of it. That if it is deficient, what will happen? You will develop angioneurotic edema. Am I clear? Okay, now talk about some other regulators. Let's talk about alternate pathway regulator. I will draw the alternate pathway here again. Yes, what was this? C1? This was C3B. This is C3B. And what is here? This activates which one? BB. And both of them together activate? Yes, please, hurry up. Please tell me C3B. Right. Now, these three together are called C5 converters. For this pathway to go ahead, there should be enough C3B there. There should be enough C3B there on the membrane in active form. Is that right? If it is there in enough amount, only then this pathway will go further and work. Right? There is a regulator applied here. And a very important thing. This point is regulated positively as well as negatively. Right? Positive regulator for this is propyridine. There is a protein called, protein is present in the blood. That protein is called propyridine. And it loves to put them together. This protein, which keeps them together so that they work well. This is called, this is a very proper protein for enhancing their activity. So we call it propyridine. This propyridine protein is actually stabilizer of this complex. So it means it positively regulates the activation. Am I right? Because if propyridine is more there, there will be more activation, and if it is less there, if propyridine is absent, this pathway will not work further. Is that right? This is positive regulation. But the same step has negative regulator also. The same step has negative regulator as well. Okay. I will make, this is the central, and again this is C3. Yes, please. B. BB. C3. B. C3B, C3B, and BB. Am I clear? Now, there is a negative regulator also. If there is enough propyridine, this pathway will go ahead. But there is another protein. I think it should be made black because it's not good. This protein actually grabs C3 only. It holds the C3, and once it is holding the C3B, only then another protein will come here, the friend of it, the friend of this one, that will sit over here. This is a friend, is that right? And you know what this friend will do? It has a cutter, and it will, you can say, it will so first one is holding it and second one is cutting it, and if this complex is working well, it will be constantly destroyed. Can pathway move forward? No. So it's positive regulator or negative regulator? Negative regulator. This is called, only very simple name, this is called H factor. H factor. Right? And this is called, yes, I factor. Thank God they did not put very complex name for them. I remember it in a very simple way. H factor will hold. H for H factor, of course, and H for holding. H factor will hold. I will go to cut. But you have to hold it. Is that right? So simple. Now you may be thinking, why you know this? When I will teach you nephrology, there's a special type of glomerulonephritis in which there is some immune dysfunction of these proteins and person develops glomerulonephritis. Is that right? Right now you just trust me, I'm right, that for this pathway there are positive regulators and there are negative regulators. Positive regulator is propyridine, negative regulator is H and I factors. Until these two are in big amount, they keep on digesting it away, holding and digesting, holding and digesting, and alternate pathway will not be inappropriately stimulated. Is that clear? There's no problem with this? Sure? Okay, after having said all this, let's talk about one more thing. No one asked me a very important question. You should have asked one thing, that if there are so many bacteria, there are so many immune reactions which may occur in our body, so if complement system is activated, why it does not damage our normal cells? These are like time bombs. These are small bombs which are stimulated to damage the bacteria or fungi. But usually they do not damage our own tissue significantly. They don't damage our healthy tissue. They may damage the tumor cells, but they don't damage our healthy tissue. What could be the reason? I will ask a very important question in a very simple way. Let's suppose I have an inflammation in this area. Blood is coming from arterial sides, passing through capillaries and going back through venous side. If there is inflammation here, complement are activated. If complement are activated here, RBCs which are passing through this area, complement should attack them and produce hemolysis. But do you think normally hemolysis occur? No. It doesn't happen that every inflammatory area when RBCs pass by, they break down. Do they break down? No. It means that our own cells like RBCs, WBCs and platelets should have some defenses against the complement product. And which complement product is most dangerous? C5b 6789, that is membrane attack complex. This is a very dangerous product, and our cells should normally physiologically should have some defense against that. Do you know some defense mechanism against that, or I should tell you? Our cells have to defend against, if you are going in the war and throwing everywhere bullet, you should have a bulletproof jacket. So RBC should have some defenses, so that it's passing through the war zones, but it should not be undergoing hemolysis. Yes. Who will tell me? Okay, I will tell you. Right, listen. I will tell you. Actually, microbes do not have certain proteins which we have. Many of our cells have special protein on their surfaces, and these proteins which are present on the cell surfaces, any complement, activated complement factor come near, they just cut it and destroy it. Is that right? Should I tell you those products which are protecting us? Okay, do you know that RBCs, WBCs and platelets are derived from a single cell, pluripotent stem cell? There is a pluripotent stem cell in the bone marrow from where RBCs, WBCs and platelets are derived. Let's suppose this is a pluripotent stem cell. It has a nucleus. In the nucleus, there is a special protein, gene. This gene produces the product. And this product is, yes. This product is producing a protein, and this protein is anchored in the cell membrane. This is cell membrane. Is that right? And this protein which is anchored in the cell membrane. Is that right? Now, on this blue protein, this which is providing a base, what is this thing? This is complement cutter. This is another protein which is anchored on that. And in the future, this system will be inherited by RBCs, WBCs, and platelets. So all of them will have such cell membrane protein. At the top of this, there are complement inactivating proteins present. So that when RBCs are passing through some very dangerous area of inflamed area and complement are trying to attack, RBCs keep on neutralizing the complement and pass happily through that. Are you clear? One of this protein which inhibit the complement system is called decay accelerating factor. It accelerates the decay of, breakdown of C3 convertase and C5 convertase. And other name for the same thing is CD59. Similar protein, similar functions are done by CD59, similar functions are done by another protein CD55. So there are many different type of proteins which are present on the cell membranes which are acting as complement cutters so that when complement try to destroy our cells know how to protect them. These are the dogs to bite others. If they come to us, we shoot them. Is that clear? No problem? Now, again, why I'm telling you? Because there's a very important disease in which the system is disturbed. There's no fun in learning the basic if you don't know the clinical related with that. Am I right or wrong? In the end, you are going to be doctor. So doctor should know the clinical diseases, and these days modern doctors should know the clinical diseases in relation to molecular basis. So there is a disease in which, look at it, we'll start from here. This is mutant. This gene is called PIGA gene. I will not go into detail. Phosphatidyl, inositol, glycan A protein. This gene produces a protein which produces an enzyme. That enzyme produces these anchor proteins. Is that right? Actually, if this is a mutant, if this gene is mutant, can you produce these anchor proteins? And if you cannot produce the anchor proteins, can they properly anchor? No. So cells will not have enough defenses. You get me? There's a disease. This is acquired disease, that there's a mutation occurs in some pluripotent stem cells in the bone marrow, and due to that mutation, right, the proteins which provide the anchor space for the decay accelerating factor and other complement inhibiting proteins, for them this base is not there. Let me repeat, it's worth repeating, that there's a disease. Of course I will ask you the name of disease, but first you listen. There's a disease in which there's acquired mutation. It is not inherited disease, it's acquired disease. So due to mutation, right, we are unable to produce those proteins which act as anchors for complement inhibiting proteins, like anchors for decay accelerating factors are not there. Anchors for CD59 and CD55 are not there. So can such RBCs, WBCs and platelets protect themselves from against the hostile complement? No. So what happens to these patients? Look, in these patients, especially at night, RBCs are unable to protect against the complement. Maybe one factor is that at night breathing is less, carbon dioxide is retained, and in acidic environment complement are more activated. Anyway, what happens that these patients have RBCs, WBCs and platelets which are more vulnerable to the attack of complement. So they tend to develop what? They tend to develop hemolysis, right? These patients develop, number one, hemolysis. RBCs breakdown inappropriate. And this hemolysis occur within the blood. RBCs breakdown within the blood. They develop intravascular hemolysis. And these patients, when in the morning urine, they find hemoglobin. You know, RBCs have hemoglobin, you must be knowing that. And when RBCs break down, hemoglobin come out. And hemoglobin molecule, the small molecule, they can leak through glomeruli and appear into urine. So if I'm having this disease, RBCs will break down in my circulation, and from broken RBCs, what will release? Hemoglobin, and hemoglobin will go into urine, and I will have hemoglobinuria. What problem I will have? Yes, please. Hemoglobinuria, especially in the morning, right? Due to, because urine is concentrated. Number one. Number two. With this, there may be also, that is less dramatic, there is damage to the neutrophils, so more infections. And there is inappropriate damage to the platelets, so they tend to develop venous thrombosis. Is that right? Now, they have given the name of this condition. Yes, can you tell me the name? Oh, thank God I did not offer any dollar. Thank God I did not offer any dollar. All of you know the name. That is paroxysmal. Paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria. Right? The name of condition is paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobinuria. Now let me tell you the things. Paroxysmal is a misnomer. it should not be called paroxysmal, because usually majority of the patient have chronic hemolysis, not episodic. Is that right? Nocturnal is also misnomer, because they develop hemolysis in the daytime also, not only during the night. But usually, because in the morning urine is concentrated, so hemoglobin urea is more visible in the morning. Urine is brown, but even the daytime urine you check, hemoglobin is there in these patients. Hemoglobin urea is also misnomer, because not only they have hemoglobin urea and hemolysis, not only they have damage of the only RBCs, they have damage in platelets and white blood cells also. So you have to remember one thing: paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobin urea is a misnomer. Usually condition is not paroxysmal in majority of the patient. Usually condition is not nocturnal in most of the patient, and usually it is not limited to only hemoglobin urea, but there is damage to the neutrophils and platelets as well, right? But anyway, when they discovered this disease initially, right, they were able to appreciate these things more than other dysfunctions, so they put the name paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobin urea. So now you know what is the pathogenesis of paroxysmal nocturnal hemoglobin urea. You want me to repeat or it's enough? Okay, you can rewind the video if you want to repeat. Right, so we can say decay accelerating factor was also one of the regulator of activity of complement system, because until it is there, it inhibits the complement attack on our own tissue. Is that right? Because decay accelerating factor especially keep on destabilizing C3 convertase as well as destabilizing the C5 convertase, so it does not allow the formation of NF C5B6789, that is membrane attack complex, and protect our tissue against it. Any question here? There's no question. Let's have a break. Yes. Now we will discuss few more clinical points related with the complement system. Let's talk about deficiencies of complement factors. Some people have deficiency of early complement factor, especially deficiency of C3. If you have deficiency of C3, you have a tendency to develop staphylococcal infections, right, or gram-positive bacterial infection, especially in the sinuses and respiratory tract. Usually in USMLE, they put a question like this. Because it is inherited, they say there's a child who is coming again and again with unduly high frequency of sinus and respiratory tract infections, and every time infections responds very well to the antibiotics, but again infections develop. What could be the reason? Is that right? There could be many reasons. One of the reason is that baby may have deficient levels of serum level of C3, because when C3 is not there, then of course you cannot make C3B, and C3B is the opsonin. You know, C3B is opsonin, and if you have enough C3B, then against the bacteria, when you activate the complement, you generate enough C3B. And if bacteria are, this is a bacteria, right, if they are having lot of C3B deposited on them, this is for C3B deposited on bacteria. You know that neutrophils and macrophages have a receptor for this is the receptor protein for C3B. So C3B on one side holds the bacteria and other side it holds the neutrophil, so that neutrophil can very efficiently phagocytose and destroy the bacteria, and bacteria have no chance to escape, right? And when you have low level of C3, you have a high tendency to develop respiratory tract infections of gram-positive bacteria. Then this is about the initial factors. If you have deficiency of terminal factor mean C5B deficiency or 6, 7, 8, 9, it means you are not able to make membrane attack complex, or any one of these is deficient, or multiple of them is deficient, then Mr. Abdul should be knowing what type of infection occur. Neisseria gonorrhea or Neisseria meningitis. For some unknown reason, they say that these factors are really required for destruction of Neisseria gonorrhea and Neisseria gonococci and meningococci, right? Most probable reason is that those bacteria are better attacked by membrane attack complex. Is that right? Other immune wings don't handle those bacteria as well. So if you have inherited deficiency of any one of late factors, then you are unable to make enough membrane attack complex, and especially nasal infections become very common. From here, it reminds me of one more condition in which nasal infections are very common and related with complement system. Some people have inherited deficiency of menin binding lectins. You remember I taught you in the last lecture, there is menin binding lectins present in our blood, and these substances bind with the bacterial menins, and then these substances activate C2 and 4. There is no need of IgG, IgM, and there is no need of C1, and that is called lectin pathway. She knows it so well. Is that right? So some people have deficiency of this thing and lectin pathway does not work. For some curious reasons, again, nasal infections are more common in them. So here are nasal infection, and here is also nasal infections. And what are the infections here? Gram-positive, especially Staphylococcal aureus infection in paranasal sinuses and upper respiratory tract when there is deficiency of C1. Am I clear? So these three deficiencies are clear. Then C1 esterase inhibitor deficiency, we have already discussed that if C1 esterase inhibitor is deficient, which disease will occur now? I will not offer any dollars. Yes? Angioneurotic edema. Thank you very much for remembering that. And then some people have deficiency of especially C2 and C4. They have inherited defect or acquired defect, chronic deficiency of these two factors. So in these patients, immune complexes cannot be eliminated. Let me tell you how immune complexes are eliminated. Because let me correlate few facts. Fact number one is that people who have C2 and C4 deficient, they have a high tendency to develop SLE. SLE is systemic lupus erythematosus. The very special point about this disease is the multiple autoreactive B cell activated, which produce the autoantibodies against multiple tissue. What happens in SLE? Multiple B cell clones are reacting against your own tissues. There is polyclonal activation of autoreactive B cells. So antibodies are directed against DNA, antibodies are directed against RBCs, WBCs, platelets, skin component, and so many other things in SLE. You can, best way to remember SLE is, I'm just kidding, but it is true. You make a big bag and put a lot of autoimmune diseases into that and close the bag. The whole bag is called SLE, because in SLE, so many autoimmune reactions against so many tissues. Now, you must scratch your own head. I cannot scratch because they're less here. If you scratch your head, you should come up with the answer why deficiency of C2 and C4 should produce more chances of SLE. Yes. Should I answer? Let me tell you. Actually, in all of us, every day there are a lot of antigens coming and antibodies react with them. And antigen-antibody complexes form. These immune complexes, which are regularly formed in most of us, should be rapidly eliminated. They should not deposit here and there in the body. Because if these immune complexes get deposited into multiple tissue, they will activate the complement and produce inflammatory lesions. Am I clear? That normally we are producing a lot of immune complexes. Thank God these immune complexes are very rapidly cleared. Because if they remain in our body for a long time, they deposit here and there and produce a lot of undue activation of complement system and inflammatory reactions. Am I clear? Now, first of all, we should know how immune complexes are normally cleared. Let me tell you. Let's suppose these are the antigen which is present in your body. Right? And these antigens are, let's suppose, present in your blood in high amount. Antibodies will come and bind with them. Am I clear? When antigen-antibody bind, IgG or IgM, their tails will become active. And activated tails will produce what? Yes, C1, 4, 2, and C3b. Is that right? Of course, 4b, 2b, and 3b. 3b is very important. Why? Because it is option N. right? So C3B receptors are present on what? The C3B receptor present on phagocytic cells. Is that right? So listen carefully that antigen antibody complexes may partially activate the complement up to what degree? C3B. And then C3B stick to neutrophil and macrophage, and neutrophil and macrophage rapidly eat up whole this complex. This is how normally physiologically antigen antibody complexes are removed from your circulation. Am I clear? Really? Now, if you have chronic deficiency of C4 and C2, can you produce enough C3B and this chain can be produced?
No.
So can antigens be removed from your body? So antigens circulate for short time or long time?
Long time.
And these antigens will inappropriately stimulate the immune system and multiple auto-reactions may start and SLE-like problem may start. Am I clear or just teaching myself?
Yeah.
Really? What did I say? That what is the relationship between deficiency of C2 and C4 and SLE? We should know there is some activity of this thing which eventually, if that activity is absent, SLE will occur. First, we should know what is SLE. It's an autoimmune disease in which multiple auto reactions are going on. Multiple B cells are converting into plasma cells and producing multiple autoantibodies against multiple different tissues. That is SLE, basic concept. Of course, I will teach you in detail. There will be 5 hours lecture on SLE and pathology. But here we just mentioned that it is a disease in which multiple auto reactions are occurring. Now, what is the link between two? We'll make the chain. Actually, whenever there is chronic antigenemia, risk of SLE increases. When antigens remain in your blood for a long time, we call it chronic antigenemia. Risk of autoimmune diseases increases. Whenever C2 and 4 are deficient, clearance of our immune complexes and antigens out of blood is impaired. So antigens remain in your body for longer time, inappropriate overstimulation of B cells, and eventually leading to SLE-like problem. Am I clear? No problem. Then we can talk about another acquired problem related with complement. Sometimes there is hypocomplementemia, but not due to inherited factors. Let me tell you. If you have some disease in which there is some disease in which lot of immune complexes are moving in your blood, there's too much high concentration of immune complexes, they will underuse the complement system or overuse, and eventually C3 will be consumed a lot and you will develop C3 hypocomplementemia. The classical example is again SLE. There are people who have normal level of initially C2 and C4 and everything, but they develop the disease of SLE, not due to this, some other reason. If you develop any autoimmune disease in which maybe that autoimmune disease is rheumatoid arthritis, or that autoimmune disease is SLE, or that autoimmune disease is any autoimmune disease in which immune complexes are circulating in the blood for a long time, these immune complexes keep on stimulating the complement system so that immune complexes should be eliminated. But if immune complexes are too much, they overwhelm the clearance mechanism and still exist in, but they inappropriately use too high amount of complement, C3 levels will go down. This is one of the way to diagnose the immune complex systemic diseases, right? If you do, in SLE, one of the part of the diagnosis is take the serum C3 level. If complement factor number 3 levels are low, you can suspect that there is some disease which is consuming the complements. In many glomerulonephritis also, complement C3 levels go down. Am I clear? Really? Okay. So this was acquired. Then another condition in which C3 levels may be low is liver diseases. C3 are produced by the liver. If there are liver destruction like alcoholic cirrhosis or chronic hepatitis B, hepatitis and cirrhosis, so naturally hepatocyte mass becomes less and liver synthetic capability becomes less. So C3 levels in the blood will be less. Right? So C3 hypocomplementemia may be due to reduced production of C3, Classical example is liver diseases. Or C3 level deficiency may be due to overutilization of C3. The classic example are immune complex diseases. Am I clear? And you know, when C3 levels are very low, you are very susceptible to gram-positive bacteria, which may produce special infections in nasal sinuses and respiratory system. Another condition in which complements are too much used is ABO incompatibility. When mismatched blood is transfused, for example, my blood group is, I have a A positive blood. So this is my circulation and my RBCs are having A antigen. My blood group is A, right? And if I need, and of course, if my blood group is A, my antibody will be anti-B. I should not have anti-A, otherwise my antibodies will destroy my own RBCs. People who have blood group A, they have anti-B. And let's suppose this is another person, and he has RBCs with the B antigen, so his blood group is B. And his antibodies are anti, his antibodies must be anti-A. These are anti-A antibodies, and of course, here there are anti-B antibodies. Now, if unfortunately, by an accidental situation, wrongly, you give this blood to this person, what reaction will occur? This is the donor and that is the recipient. Listen, these anti-A antibodies from the donor, when they will enter into recipient blood, they will get extremely diluted. So they will not successfully attack the recipient RBC. So when mismatched blood transfusion occur, the donor's antibodies, when they are transfused to the recipient blood, donor's antibody gets diluted in the blood of plasma of recipient, and they don't build enough concentration to destroy the recipient RBCs. But when donor's RBCs come here, can RBC dilute themselves? Can the RBCs dilute their membrane antigens? No. There are thousands of the antigens which are fixated on the RBC's membrane. So when donor's RBC enter into recipient blood, and if donor RBC is incompatible, what was the donor RBC? This was B. So these antibodies will attack. So what will happen? During mismatch ABO transfusion, these are the donor's RBCs which are destroyed by recipient antibodies within the recipient circulation. And when this RBC is break down here, and this RBC will break down, it will release hemoglobin. Right? Now, exactly what happened? When this is the supposed B antigen, and here was anti-B antibody. As soon as this antibody will touch this antigen, this is IgM. It will activate the? And activate? Yes, yes. C1, 4, 2, 3, 5B, 6, 7, 8, 9. Drill the RBC. Membrane attack complex. So what happens? Next time you imagine, if you do a mistake, ABO incompatibility, then donor's RBCs in the recipient blood is attacked by the recipient antibodies, and who will suffer? Donor will suffer or recipient will suffer? Recipient. Of course, the recipient will suffer because donor is free of his RBCs. These are donor's RBCs which are blasting in recipient blood. So these are donor's RBCs having the antigens on which recipient antibodies bind, and recipient antibodies activate the recipient's complement system. A lot of complement products are produced. Membrane attack complexes are produced, will lead to hemolysis of RBCs. And of course, C4A, C2A, C3A, C5A are generated. They activate all the mast cells. Mast cell produce histamine, vasodilatation. Blood pressure will fall after ABO incompatibility. Mast cell will produce histamines in the lungs, bronchoconstriction. So patient develops shock. You are understanding why? That because complements are activated, C4A, 2A, 3A, 5A, they activate the mast cell all over the body. Remember, mast cells are present in all connective tissue, but they are specially concentrated under the skin and mucosal linings. Right? Once you know that, when all over the blood, mast cell, when all over the blood, complement factors are generated due to ABO incompatibility, these activate the mast cells. When mast cells around the blood vessels activate, they produce a product, we dilate the blood vessel, then blood pressure falls. Is that right? Then increased permeability will occur due to histamine, so rashes. Then in the bronchial tree, these products of complement, they activate the mast cell and release histamine and bronchoconstriction. Is that right? So patient, what are the problems of the patient? As soon as mismatched blood enters, patient develop pain along the line, IV line. Of course, mast cells are being degranulated around that. With that, patient will develop shock-like condition, bronchoconstriction, abdominal cramps, and pains in the loins. Why? Why? Because RBCs are breaking and releasing hemoglobin. Hemoglobin filters through the glomerular membrane, accumulating into his kidney, proximal convoluted tubule, damaging the proximal convoluted tubule, precipitating acute tubular necrosis. Do you really want to know how exactly it occurs? Okay, let me tell you. This is your circulation, and here is your nephron, right? Normally, hemoglobin is packed within the RBC, and normally RBCs don't leak in a healthy person. So hemoglobin cannot leak, but due to AB incompatibility, RBCs are ruptured. So hemoglobin is released. The molecular weight of hemoglobin is 64 kilodalton. Hemoglobin is tetrameric protein. You know it,
yes.
Right? So as this tetrameric protein come out, it break down into dimers. Dimers are so small they can filter down. Patient will develop hemoglobin urea. Plus, when lot of hemoglobin is going down here, it will clog the proximal convoluted tubule. And these very stupid proximal convoluted tubule, they think why this is blocked. They try think this is some delicious dish of hemoglobin coming. They start pinocytosis and start eating up the hemoglobin. And hemoglobin enter into these cells, it releases the iron. Iron is highly reactive and damages these cells. So if patient does not die due to shock, he will have acute tubular necrosis, and you will see first urine will be coming with lot of hemoglobin, and then urine output drops dangerously, and he will be in renal failure. Yeah, am I clear to you people? So this is one more example in which inappropriate complement activation due to AB incompatibility leads to shock-like condition, and if patient survive, there may be renal failure, acute renal failure, of course. That's all about complements.